my first call to the stage, Anthony DeFranco, to explain to you the history of the Editor Wars. That's what they mean. In 3 minutes, or five, or something.
Okay. I guess the most important bit of context is that in the art and science of programming computers, I think we're at a general point right now that is comparable to like hammering cuneiform into clay tablets in the art and science of writing, and that is a big part of why I am so eager to see many more people who are not part of an in-group who just repeat the same thing to each other over and over again that they're supposed to repeat about how you solve problems, and that's great. So, more specifically, the Editor Wars. So, a long time ago, perhaps a generation or two, you would like flip switches on the front of panels and it would make lights go on, or you would punch cards or something, and all of this gave people, I think, very low standards about how they were going to interact with computers. And then eventually people were on very slow, unreliable terminals where you might edit your text one line at a time. And of course, even though the structure of your program is actually not really a sequence of characters and a lot of work has to be done to like extract the real structure of your program, which is much more tree-like, from the sequence of characters, and people have indeed talked about and occasionally built systems where you would interact with your program in that more direct form and it would make many kinds of errors impossible and be able to tell you much more about what you should do next. None of that has really happened, and what we're still doing is like typing text out, and then all of that other stuff happens behind the scenes and you kind of have to know in your head how all that works, and it's annoying. Even to me after like many years, but and probably even more so to someone who hasn't spent many years internalizing all that. So, but at least we don't have to here's the thing that we just got past 40 years ago and we're still at now, is that instead of like editing line by line and having to tell your editor like, okay, print this line and show it to me and now change it here and now put it back in, we can actually have a whole like chunk of text on the screen at once and we can scroll around on it. So like we've got that. And we've had that for 30 or 40 years, so it's, I guess that's a kind of progress. And then the Editor Wars were a bunch of people who didn't really want to engage with the substance of what to do next, I think, and instead were like, let's create a religious war around which way of shuffling text around is slightly more ergonomic. And I think part of it was, like, some of them were more socially associated with MIT and some were more socially associated with Berkeley. Or maybe even not, that's one of the many things that was irrelevant that was influencing the milieu. And then one of them was Emacs, and it was like the one that he's going to talk about. And then the other one is called VI, and a lot of the details of what makes them different are not really that interesting. But Emacs is actually one of the better ones that we've got right now, which is kind of ignoring the last 35 years of research that people have done on the topic, but people are actually using this one, and it's like, if you want to use something and then actually be able to talk to other people who are using it, this is a pretty good one, and a lot of stuff it does all right. And with that, having said that in exactly that way, I will give you Max, who will tell you about how to use it and
I'll come back.
Like Emacs, the good parts.
Yeah, so I don't even use Emacs when I'm on my regular, you know, if I have a better editor at hand or it's like a visual one. But like you may need to use it occasionally because you're logging into something that doesn't have a graphical user interface. In that case, I learned Emacs. So the Emacs program is spelled like this, and you can launch it by like, whoops. Okay, so this is actually launching a visual Emacs. So the way that I have to talk about it, that you'll probably interact with it on regularly is there'll be no window system. So like now I'm just completely inside of it, otherwise it will launch like its own graphical user interface. What's so cool about Emacs Well, oftentimes it's said that Emacs is a great operating system that lacks a decent text editor. So, okay, first of all, check this out. I'm going to press the letter I, and the letter I is going to appear on screen. So we're already doing quite a lot of good things. Okay, I'm not sure if I want to... Okay, look, check this out in Emacs, right? It just brings me up to a scratch space. And then if I press... Okay, and like also, a lot of people that like VI say that Emacs is bad because you have to press Control a lot. So if you think that that is annoying to press Control, then it's not for you. But if you're like many modern computer users and are used to pressing Control all the time, then what's the big deal, you know? So Control X 2 will split your screen into two, and if you press Control X 0, you can move around. There'll be two screens, and there'll be two buffers. And if you do Control X 5, Control X F, then you will be able to find a new file. So now I'm in the mini buffer, which is at the very bottom, and it's asking me where I want my new file to be, and it's going to be called like myfile.txt. And so now I can just write text here, and then if I press Control X O, then I can, like, there are two windows happening at the moment. So that's already like why that's really cool, because you know, you may want to, like, you're on a remote server and you want to edit two documents at the same time, well, like, that's really great. And then, like, say you want to edit three documents at the same time, well, you can do that as well. And, you know, it's like, oh, wow, I have a really bad windowing system without having a windowing program installed. And then you can press Control X O to go around that. So, yeah, Emacs is not... modal. So everything you do in Emacs is going to be based around pressing a sequence like Control X or something, or Meta X, and the Meta key is normally the Alt key on your keyboard. Okay, so let's just make a new file. So you're in Emacs, you probably are in a buffer, maybe you're in the scratch buffer. I'm going to delete this so that you can see what's happening. Blah, blah, blah.
Just as a side note, before class you had showed a couple of us how to get into Emacs just on our terminals.
Yeah.
I don't know if everybody heard that.
Okay. Well, typically you boot up the Emacs program by writing Emacs, E-A-M-E-M-A-C-S.
What am I going to say about Emacs?
Yeah, it's really great because you can split the screens and stuff. So here's an example. I think I'm going to tell you less about which keys to hit and then just demonstrate some of its functionality. So, like, let's say that this was, I'm going to, like, okay, my computer program needs to, like, have these features or something, like this. And now I want to write my Python thing, so I press Control X O and I switch over to here. And, like, now I have this other file. Oops. Okay, sometimes it... Okay, so now I'm going to make a little bit of, like, a Python thing.py. And, so my Python program is a Hello World program. And, like, maybe it has some features. And, like, it's going to, like, do all my tab completion for me and stuff. So,
because you're in a context for Python?
Yeah, well, I named it .py, and then Emacs will automatically put syntax highlighting on. So, now I'm doing a split screen mode, and then one of the cool things about this is that... Oops. Okay, so there are many different buffers, and you can see I'm switching between all of them. But one of the things that is useful about, and I actually don't remember if I can do this, it might take me a second to get this, but you can do something like this, which is, if I type in meta x shell, I will get a shell here, and now I can execute, like now I'm in the shell in a small window of my Emacs thing, and I think that...
I go over here and do Control X B, then tab, and then tab, I can like go over to this one, and then I do that. Okay, there we go. So you can see I'm working on this file, and this could happen in JavaScript because Emacs has plugins for everything. Let's say that I now want to, I'm testing my program. I'm on a remote server, and I just want to like debug it. All I have to do is to press Control CC here, and then it ran in the live interpreter in the small screen over there. So now you can see that like what's cool about it is that I just have multiple windows running with a click of a button or a keyboard. Then I can like start executing the thing that was in my window in another window over there. So that's why how you can sort of see that this is basically an operating system. But you can also write in it, and it's nice that you don't have to. So I said things like Control C, Control X, and stuff like that. But I think that the part of the thing that people are annoyed about Vim is that they have to remember what Q does and like what R does or whatever. But the nice thing about Emacs is that it has those things as well. But you never have to remember them. So if you always just remember how to do the thing meta X, which is like alt X, then it's difficult to see that MX comes up here. And then it has a really useful help system. And like also everything is tab completed. So like if I don't remember how to do, so let's say that I want to do a search and replace here, but I don't remember how to do search and replace. Then I can do meta X. And I'm like, I know it's the replace thing, so I start typing RE, and it shows me all the possible completions. And so it's like, oh, now I've auto-completed to replace string. And so now it's just like, I start doing replace string here without having to remember. I just like typed in replace string, and it knows, it like helped me figure out what the actual command was. So now I'm going to replace the string feature, and then it asks me what I want to replace it with. And then I'll say like, wonky, and it replaced one occurrence. And it did it in that, I was actually in this active buffer, and I wanted to do it in this one. So I'll go over here and do replace string. And it's just like, it remembered what I did last time, so I hit enter. And then, so replace string, there's probably like a shortcut to it, but you never have to use the shortcut because you can just write things out in full. And the help system is pretty useful. So the joke is like MX does everything. So if you do MX help, it will display, a help system. MX help. Okay, I guess I can't switch windows while that's active. So I can close these windows, but it won't ever mean that I am, they're gone. They're just buffers and they're just not active. So if I do, I can still always look at which buffers are available, and Emacs tells me that the completions buffer, the auto completions buffer is active, the messages buffer is active, the Python buffer is active, and I'm editing a thing called python thing.py. So I can just like open and close my windows at will. And if I want to get the help system up, I can like type A for pattern, and so then like, oh, I really want to remember how to do a search. And so in Emacs, it will remind me that it will tell me all the commands that are available that have the word search in them. And like perhaps I'm doing an index search, and that's these specific commands. So it has a help system that's built in. I search forward, that's the one I like. So if I'm in this other one and I do MX I search, that's the iterative search. So search for the term wonky, and it found those terms, and I can go through them now. Selecting them. So you don't have, like, I think one of the nice things about Emacs is that you don't have to remember any of the commands because you can just, like, figure them out pretty easily. What
Yeah, it allows between everything.
It, you can do this. Like when you're bored. And like perhaps you're like, you want to make two at the same time, or wait. Like one of them, like you want to be editing your Python thing, and you also want to like it helps you to do Tetris at the same time. So like I can like just, you know, switch in between playing the game and like editing my thing. And like maybe that's not enough, so I can like call up the doctor. And the doctor says, I'm the psychotherapist. Okay. Control X B. Okay. Please describe your problem. Each time you have finished talking, press return. Like, I am failing at presenting. Emacs, huh? I would appreciate if you could continue. Like, the psychotherapist will help you through your problems. Is it because you have problems that you came to me? Well, there you go. So, it's just really, it has a lot of features and it's very interactive. There was something else I wanted to say about it. Oh, yeah. Copying and pasting works really well in Emacs, by the way, as well as being able to play Tetris. So, okay, here's another print statement. Okay, so you do one cut, like, okay, so in Emacs, if you want to select regions, you press Control Space, and that starts the selector, and then you go to where you want to stop, and then you cut using Control W. And then normally, this would seem really dangerous if you were, like, editing in Word, or I think, I actually didn't save the end of the Vim thing, but I just cut something else out. So normally, like, my clipboard has only got one space, but in Emacs, when you paste, it pastes the last thing, but if you continue pasting, it will paste the next thing, and like all the things in your memory. So like your clipboard is a big ring, and Emacs is really, really safe because like you can undo, and you've never lost anything. So I like it for that reason. It's also, yeah.
How big is the limit on those buffers?
More than
practical. Okay, awesome.
Yeah.
Are they lost when you exit? Or are they persistently saved for if you open up the book later?
I'm not entirely sure on that.
Okay.
But it's Emacs is really customizable, is what people like as well. So you might be able to save those things into your history. Like it might be able to be configured in that way. So another nice thing that can happen is that because this isn't, Emacs has different modes for different programming languages. So I think we're in Python mode, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm in Python mode and. Actually, you can see that because I have this like Python drop-down menu available here. So I can do, okay, so I was going to do MX. There are like some useful things. So these are the possible things that Emacs knows how to do with Python. It can like indent my stuff automatically, navigate. But I think it has like, it can do some skeleton stuff. Or it can send your document directly to an interpreter. So like let's say that I wanted to make a Python skeleton. Where's the class? Okay, class. So it asks me what the class name wants to be, and I'll call it my class. And then it asks me what it wants to inherit from, and I will just say like parent. And then are there anything else to inherit from? Not at the moment. And then gets me to fill in the doc string, and it's like, this class does this. So it can also just like help you to like automatically format your code and get everything done right properly. And it supports, I think it does. Okay, look, as well as that being in Emacs mode, Emacs has a VI mode that will make it VI inside of Emacs. So, like
Swiss Army knife.
Wait, there's more.
Yeah. I don't even really know how to use it because I don't use it, but text is reader.
Just a quick question while you're exploring that.
Yeah.
Is it you were mentioning that there were VI keystrokes that can be used within Emacs, is that correct?
Yeah, well, if you like activate VI mode, then all of the same keys that would normally work for you in VI just work in Emacs.
Oh, okay, only in VI mode. Okay.
Yeah, and then you just turn VI mode off when you're finished.
Can you change the font?
Can you change the font?
Yeah.
Describe font. I think that it's defaulting to mine being, it's always going to be monospace, but you can change, I think it's using the font that my terminal was interpreting, and that's why it looks Ubuntu-y at the moment. So, does the shell in general have fonts, or does it just display characters and then your computer interprets the characters?
You configure the terminal separately with the font.
So it only is ever pushing like byte characters to you, and then you're like rendering them, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
You use Xemacs.
What's it?
You use the Emacs that goes directly into the Windows system and then use its own configuration.
Yeah.
I guess a bigger question is it the display of Emacs customizable at all?
You were talking about the color scheme and stuff?
Yeah, it's kind of just a bit distracting.
Yeah, this is the way that I have it set up, but set change related actually. Yes, is the short answer. Okay, I don't know exactly which the right fonts are, but I don't actually know how to change the color in Emacs.
But the answer is yes, it's possible.
Yeah, it's like it's the most customizable thing, so you could change the color scheme in that. So the really nice Emacs has also got the things where you can move around, but I just use the arrow keys because our keyboards now have arrow keys, and that seems to make a lot of sense to me. And I just like to be able to type, and with just knowing a few things like Control X 3 splitting up windows and moving between those windows, that will make your life easier on remote machines. So I don't really gonna. That's just a tour of Emacs. If you ever feel like you need those features on a remote service. Okay, so I think that's going to be it for me on that stuff. I'll take questions now.
So when you type Emacs into your terminal, this whole interface launches to you?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so this is Emacs. Well, Emacs actually defaults to being a windowed program. That's like in my regular windowing system. But it also can run in the shell. So that's useful, like... Okay, so I'm going to SSH into this remote server. Okay, so now I'm actually in the Wikimedia server. And it looks a bit funny because... let me just... Okay, so like now I'm just somewhere else, right? And if I launch Emacs, like I have just the same thing here. It's just as easy for me to split windows and find new files. So, like that's just the key, like that's the great part about it, is that like it operates as a windowed system on your own system. And everything that you learn from there is available to you in the same way, and looks the same way on the server. So you get the convenience of home when you're home, and then like your hotel has the same bed sheets as you're used to when you're on the road. okay. And it comes from this Lisp tradition, which I tend to favor because I think that's a more elegant programming style than the ways that the modern language, like some other languages do. But that's a side note, and I don't really want to go into it. Okay. Any other questions?
Are there certain kinds of users, like Emacs users versus Vim users? Certain kinds of personality types that prefer one.
Is that a leading question?
The thing is, you can get, like, programmers to argue about, and, like, I've had people say, like, to other people, like, I've seen your Vim settings, they're perfect. Like, I've heard that kind of thing before. So you can, like, some people have been doing this for a long time, like, you can get them to fight about it, but, like,
it's, you know. Wait, not browser
wars. The browser wars.
We need to get James back.
He's right there.
Oh yeah, look, I
don't really
that.
Know enough about Emacs to contribute much. I don't know. I try to use it, but I just don't know how it works. It's so frustrating.
So another cool thing about Emacs is, like, you can start, it's like also a file. It's also a file system editor. So like Explorer. So like I see my files, and instead of like seeding into those things, I get this weird, like, uncanny valley between being on the terminal and also being able to click and open folders, where I can just sort of, like, do this. So, like, Emacs, like, brings you into the advanced stages of the 1980s.
Vim has that feature too, but I don't like it, so I'm going to stay away from it.
Okay.
Like, yeah.
Question? Okay, so is there a non-graphical browser in Emacs? Like Lynx or...
Anthony, didn't you say there was a non-graphical browser?
Yeah, I think there are probably several that have been written in Emacs just over the years, but I think I've repressed this memory, but I
I mean, I guess the question I'm asking is within...
Look at this browser URL, HTTP, let's try and go to...
Okay.
No usable browser found. Okay.
Okay.
Emacs Wiki category web browser. So
okay.
There's a category of web browsers.
There's a whole category full of web browsers.
Okay, cool.
Are you talking about something that kind of is like,
so
will look like this?
So one is called U for Emacs web browser. And one is called W3.
Whoa.
Can you open up another window while you're...
Sorry, I'm just playing.
It's okay. Play around.
Search
images.
Okay, one actually runs the full-featured WebKit browser in Emacs.
Okay.
Go to...
Oh, wow. Look at this. That is advanced.
Okay, cool.
Okay, now I'm on the BBC.
Now, can you open up another window?
Well, this is not in Emacs. But
oh,
this
it's
is,
not?
This would
okay.
probably be a lot what a browser in Emacs would look like
okay,
if
gotcha.
You
okay.
spent 2 weeks
yeah, sure.
configuring it.
Okay.
Latest story is Paris attack. I actually kind of like reading the news this way sometimes because
mm-hmm.
it
right.
feels like teletext to me.
What's the terminal text only browser?
Lynx?
There's a lot of them. There's like dozens.
Yeah.
W3, Elynx.
Let's see if I can run Elynx in here. Okay. Shell. There you go.
Wow.
So,
okay.
And now I will like. Oh, wait, that doesn't seem like it's doing any good thing. Okay, well, I think I broke it. It's weird.
Okay, cool. So the answer is yes.
Yeah, okay, now I'm sort of browsing the web in a bad way in half of my screen.
Okay, cool. The answer is yes.
Yeah.
Cool. Thanks.
In a virtual window inside of a virtual terminal inside of a
that's
window
my question,
manager.
Actually. That's what I'm trying to
yeah.
get. Yeah.
So this is like level 7 Inception.
Okay. Yeah.
So can you log into a Wikimedia server and add like 4 more layers?
Okay, so you want me to go into okay.
So like run an Android emulator and then like log in from there.
And then maybe mirror the feed from the camera
and see if
we can.
There should
we
be
a itself in real time.
How many layers can you add where each layer has to be different? Like that could be a game. The shell inception game. Yeah, like no repeating an abstraction.
It doesn't seem to handle it very well. Yeah, it's getting a little bit messy.
I bet you Vim could handle it better.
Let's see, yeah. Let's like just settle to war. Okay.
Cool.
And of course, like, this, it's like, is this cheating? Like, how to do, you like, how to paste in Emacs? It's like not cheating, right? It's like, you're going to be logged in somewhere else, and like, you can still do that. You're still always going to be able to do that. So like, while you can always do that, then just take the editor that allows you to type directly, because you can just type directly and then just like tab over to the other one to get know what you need to do. Like okay, Vim may be faster, but like, is your life really won or lost by like how many extra letters you have to type in that thing? Like, I just don't think so. Okay, thank you.
Cool, thank you.
Woo.